presents this unabridged recording of Books That Made Us, the companion to the ABC TV series written by Carl Reinecke and read by Claudia Karvan. Forward. More Australians are reading books than ever before, and I'm no different. I was a voracious reader as a child and in my 20s, but my focus dipped when kids came along. Now they're grown up, I am returning to the books that have been patiently waiting to be read. And I promise my kids that I didn't resent their intrusion on my book reading life too much. I'm a big believer that sharing our stories, whether it's through music, art, conversation, inhabiting a character or writing, gives our lives meaning. Maybe it's because I stopped studying science in year 10, but there's a line in Muriel Rukeyser's poem, The Speed of Darkness, that says it all for me. She writes that the universe is not made up of atoms, it's made up of stories. Books are doors, not mirrors. Through books, you can travel to far-off places without leaving your bedroom. You can live a thousand lives and be transported in time, become immersed in the landscape of the writer's imagination, and experience heartbreak and love. It's not just about escaping into a book. It's also about being held. The very act of reading is a private interaction that no one else can share. You are never alone reading a book. It teaches you to enjoy your own company. It forces you to ask questions and to empathise. It's been deemed a subversive act. The more you read, the more you discover you don't know. In my life as an actor, I've been lucky enough to appear in screen adaptations of some of Australia's favourite novels, such as My Brother Jack, True History of the Kelly Gang, and Puberty Blues. There's an inordinate amount of waiting around on set, travelling and living away from friends and family for long periods, and books have always provided me with reliable solace. But like most readers, my taste is pretty scattergun and arbitrary, so I was thrilled when I was asked to host the ABC series Books That Made Us, because I wanted to learn more about Australian books. The three-part series delves into books that have really struck a nerve, books that push us to think differently about ourselves. For my role as host, I had to read almost 30 novels, ranging from Marcus Clarke's For the Term of His Natural Life to Melissa Lucashenko's Too Much Lip. And the task was an intense, focused gift, like a mini university degree in Australian literature. It gave me the opportunity to reflect on our famous historic novels and also to understand the bedrock from which our contemporary stories are being forged. I was able to meet some of our most beloved and brilliant writers and experience the places that inspired their magical stories. The most exciting thing I learned about on this journey is the triumphant emergence in Australian publishing of extraordinary Indigenous voices. Kim Scott, Melissa Lukashenko, Tara June Winch, and the inimitable Alexis Wright are all recipients of our greatest federal literary prize, the Miles Franklin, and their books are illuminating to read. It was a privilege to meet Alexis Wright and read her novel Carpenteria. It's a work of art, and she has rewritten the rulebook on structure, storytelling, and how we should read Australia. I'd never understood cyclical or time continuum until I read Carpenteria. The future is in the past, and the past is in the present. This book uses a fourth tense, not past, present, or future, but simultaneous, where the spiritual, real, and imagined worlds all exist side by side. Alexis said that Carpenteria was not written from the paternalistic viewpoint from which Australia typically portrays Indigenous people as pathetic welfare cases unable to take care of ourselves. Her book is a testament to the survival of a culture, just like That Dead Man Dance, Too Much Lip, The Yield, and the many other novels written by First Nations authors. Reading these novels, I was challenged by how often white Australians focus on the loss, the crimes, and the regrets, but neglect the wit, resilience, and spirituality of First Australians. We've all been impacted by colonisation in different ways, but these books build a movement of indigenisation, Bring it on. Wesley Enoch says it so succinctly. If we tell our stories, you can no longer oppress us. I embarked on the role of host with a moderate degree of trepidation, mainly at the hours of reading it would involve, but I underestimated how emotionally challenging the journey would be. Words are powerful. Given the territory that these novels traverse, genocide, penal cruelty, suicide, heartbreak, I guess I should have belted myself in for a rocky ride. It was edifying to revisit one of my favourite Australian novels, The Secret River, and explore how this book can speak so differently to Indigenous and white readers. Kate Grenville's historical novel brought the uncomfortable fact of our country's massacres into popular culture, and its honesty charted new territory for Australian literature. But it also elicited a strong response from people like Nakia Louie, who felt angry that white people didn't already know the truth of their history. Writers aren't famous for seeking out the limelight, and my role as interviewer isn't naturally in my wheelhouse, so I couldn't have been more grateful for the generosity of all the writers who met with me. I usually go by the old adage, you should never meet your heroes, but Helen Garner is the exception to the rule. She is as present and honest in the flesh as she is on the page. And what a pleasure to reread Monkey Grip 30 years after I'd first read it. It's timeless. Revisiting Patrick White's books was also reassuring. His words hold as much impact for me now as they did when I was in my 20s. I was already a fan of Richard Flanagan's writing, but I'd never read Death of a River Guide. It holds one of my new favourite quotes, "Death is not the complex matter. Life is." And having never heard of Sophie Laguna before, I'm now categorically a fangirl. I've read all four of her adult fiction novels, and I won't miss the ones to be published in the future. Trent Dalton, Tom Keneally, Tim Winton, and David Malouf could not have been warmer or more available. I feel so lucky to have spent such a luxurious amount of time with all of them discussing their important works. The Gerildery Letter is a revelation, and if you haven't read it yet, you must. It brings Ned Kelly to life as a living, breathing man instead of the myth, and was the lightning rod for Peter Carey's novel, True History of the Kelly Gang. To meet Michael Muhammad Ahmed and hear how Australia's racism galvanised him to tell his own story and initiate a writing movement was a highlight. I also learnt about courage from Craig Sylvie, who diligently researched and wrote the story of a trans kid in his novel Honeybee. One of the novels on my reading list was Charlotte Wood's The Natural Way of Things, a divisive book which I'd avoided reading because I'd heard it described as being about misogyny. But when I finally read it, I was pleased to be electrified by a story celebrating female friendship, courage, and instinct. This scribe of Australian writers are deep-thinking, empathetic, and courageous, and they all carry with them a weighty sense of responsibility and an understanding of what it is to tell a story. One of my most significant relationships, the one with my mother, pivots almost entirely around books. Book recommendations, discussions about books, angry disagreements about books. Our relationship has benefited from the massive education I've received in Australian literature during the course of this series, and I'm reminded daily that it is in the sharing with others that books grow into an even more powerful and nurturing force. I joined the ABC's Books That Made Us series because I wanted to read more Australian books so that I could better understand this place we call home. But I can also thank this journey for improving my reading habits. I'm now trained to never leave the house without a novel in my bag. There's always 15 minutes somewhere in the day to dip into a book. Claudia Karvan. Introduction. In her acceptance speech after winning the 2020 Miles Franklin Award, Wiradjuri author Tara June Winch described how her novel, The Yield, was ultimately about memory, about the trauma of remembering and forgetting. In this dance of remembering and forgetting, Winch questioned why so many Australians have not learned the true history of their country. The British Marine Lieutenant Watkin Tench was one of the first to attempt a true history of Australia. In his two books, A Narrative of the Expedition to Botany Bay, published in 1789, and A Complete Account of the Settlement of Port Jackson, published in 1793, Tench provided an account of the First Fleet's early years in the new colony, intending to report the facts simply as they happened. He described a remote and barbarous land populated by roaming savages who were astonished and awed by our superiority. To his eyes, they were marked by a natural hideousness that was so repugnant it was hardly possible to see anything in human shape more ugly. Surveying Australia in the present day, Tara June Winch argued in her speech that respect was still an idea too often absent in the Australian vernacular. She urged her audience to go beyond empty words and grasp the Wiradjuri concept of yindyamara, to be equal in respectful ways, to be flowing back and forth from two shores. This was an idea that Tench would probably have struggled to comprehend. He initially dismissed the Indigenous languages he heard as harsh and barbarous, and drew a stark contrast between an Indigenous savage barbarity and a European progress of reason. And so his account of the beginnings of Australia's settlement and colonisation was one of the first crucial contributions to an imperial project that Tench hoped would transfuse into these desert regions knowledge, virtue, and happiness. An endeavour that Winch noted meant that the bullet was the means of the physical subjugation, language was the means of spiritual subjugation. What transformations have occurred to convert Tench's facts into Winch's novel, a book rich in the Wiradjuri language? Why and how did the words and fictions of a European literary tradition come to define and reimagine a place on the other side of the world? How did the tradition of Australian fiction, with its rich array of important and influential novels, reflect and shape the radical changes of Australian society and culture? This book seeks to make sense of the distance between Tench's words and those of Winch, and in doing so, find an adequate response to Winch's challenge to better understand what will you refuse to forget and what will you endeavour to remember. The many changing representations of Australian life in the books that make up Australia's literary history are crucial to unpicking Winch's challenge. These range from Miles Franklin's unabashedly optimistic My Brilliant Career, published in the early years of Australian Federation, to Helen Garner's Monkey Grip, published 70 years later with its inner-city drug-taking bohemians and failed love affairs, from the nostalgic family histories of Tim Winton's Cloud Street to the modernist explorations of Patrick White's Voss, from the 19th century bushranger adventures in Rolf Boldrewood's Robbery Under Arms to the 2018 gritty comic drama Too Much Lip by Guri writer Melissa Lucashenko. Despite their differences, these and many of the other novels considered here drew on a shared literary heritage. It's a tradition that encompasses a litany of authors, each with their own distinctive preoccupations and stylistic expectations. Patrician stylists such as Henry Handel Richardson and the dedicated communist Catherine Susanna Pritchard, literary celebrities like Peter Carey and the less well-known Joseph Furphy, dissectors of social mores like Frank Morehouse, and the hermetic abstractions of Gerald Murnane. Australian literature brims over with conflicting personalities and seemingly irreconcilable works. Ours is a literary history of individual writers and distinctive books, political campaigns and ambitions, unexpected successes and frustrating disappointments. And it continues to grow every year, accumulating more books, more authors, and even more diverse fictional worlds. Here, there is a lot to remember. Peering into such a teeming past, I have selected a sample of influential books, almost all novels, to explore. I have treated them as stepping stones in the complex, crowded history of Australian literature and culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.